Coming up, the lead singer from Hurricane.
Well, lead singer in one of the most popular bands in Florida. Everybody wants to feed you cocaine.
And the price he paid for a shot at the top.
For crystal meth and rock and roll, I left my family and I never looked back.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, good morning and welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Joining us again today, our friend Scott Ross. Over the course of Scott's career, he's interviewed newsmakers and celebrities, but there's one type of star that has a special place in his heart. Those who like rock and roll. You're a rock and roller.
I even married one.
I know you did.
A Ronette. Where do you go from there? You know, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the whole deal. I was serious about this rock and roll stuff. It's here to stay. It'll never die. Well, I don't know about that. Today, I do want to talk to you about Bob Calhoun. He was in the fast track to rock and roll stardom. Only one thing was standing in his way, a minor obstacle, his family. But not for long, Bob left his wife and son, and he never looked back.
We were on our way. We started opening up for bands like Foghat, Blue Oyster Cult, Pat Travers, Molly Hatchet, John Cain Steppenwolf, The Outlaws, Red Rider. We were in negotiations with CBS Records to sign a record deal.
Bob Calhoun's quick rise to fame started in small-town Iowa. In high school, he excelled in swimming and theater. After his performance in the musical Hair, Bob was approached by a member of the group Hurricane, a popular rock band in Florida.
So the following Friday, I went to a bar, and they invited me on stage, and the rest is history.
Bob's vocal talent was just what they needed, and their fame started to grow.
There's a line outside all night long to get in. The deck out on the ocean was packed. And, you know, it's the 80s. A lead singer in one of the most popular bands in Florida, everybody wants to feed you cocaine and marijuana. And it just took control of my life. Marijuana was my drug of choice. I became addicted to cocaine, not only in the high of it, but my mindset was, if this is a drug that I'm going to do, it's highly expensive. How can I do this and not pay for it? Ah, I can sell it because I do know some people that are buying it. So I started selling cocaine, small amounts, to get what I was doing for free.
The band was offered a record contract and began touring with some of the top acts of the day. But just when the band was about to break out, they imploded.
A couple of the band members were missing their girlfriends. We had a huge concert set up, and 2 days before the concert, the drummer and our other guitar player left in the middle of the night. There was no band to come back to, so the first thing I did was, what do I know how to do? How do I know how to make money? I started selling cocaine here and there.
Bob met Lisa in 1986, and they married 2 years later. Their son Timothy was born 12 weeks premature. For the first time in his life, Bob began to pray.
I was on my knees pleading day in and day out. I was trying to cop a deal. I'll give up rock and roll. I'll give up drugs. Just let my son live.
Timothy lived, but Bob forgot his foxhole prayer.
Realistically, at that time in my life, it was all about me. And at that time in my life, not knowing who God truly is, I thought I could just pull a deal with him and back out.
As his addictions got worse, Bob started stealing cars and motorcycles.
It was like a rush, you know, an adrenaline rush.
Bob joined a new group called Trilogy, and he got a shocking offer from their promoter.
And he said, look, you know, from the day I heard you, I've told you you're the greatest rock and roll singer of all times, but honestly, I don't think you're ever gonna make it. He said, I believe your wife and your family's holding you back. He said, I'll tell you what, you can come live with me. You don't have to pay any rent, just sing. So for crystal meth and rock and roll, I left my family and I never looked back. I was to the point in my life I could hit a red light. I had everything right there in my console, fill a spoon, drop the dope, stir it up, put a little water, crush it, pull it, shoot it before the light turned green.
One night, Bob and a friend were stopped in a stolen car, and Bob was detained without bail on an immigration charge.
I was born in Germany of American parents. on an American military base. I'm an American citizen. But for some reason, there was an immigration hold on me.
The immigration hold was just a ploy to hold Bob. What they really had on him was undercover surveillance of the last 2.5 years of his life.
He said, following you is like going to a candy store. You led us to hundreds of people in the drug world.
He was sentenced to 7.5 years in prison for robbery, theft, and probation violations.
There I was sitting in county jail, sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I remember calling my mom and saying, okay, I'm ready. I'm ready to figure this out. Send me a Bible.
So his mother sent him a Bible, and Bob read it. He also stumbled upon a small paperback book.
I remember getting a book on the library cart, More Than a Carpenter, by Josh McDowell. And I remember reading it. And I think at that moment, the Holy Spirit almost became awake in me. Because I read this book and I thought, how could this intelligent man who didn't believe take these men and travel the world to prove that the Bible wasn't true, and in doing so, become believers? How is that possible? And that little simple book gave me enough incentive to go, man, I need to rethink this.
Bob decided to go to a chapel service at the prison.
I walked into this building and there was a convict standing behind the pulpit preaching the word of God like he was Billy Graham. And although there were maybe 50, 60 guys, as far as I was concerned, the room was completely empty. And he was talking to me, forgiveness, hope, born again. And I'll say this man's name. His name is Keith White, doing life for murder from Iowa. This man from Iowa was going to lead this man from Iowa. Introduced me to Jesus Christ, not a story in a book, not a song, but a Jesus Christ ready to take me for who I am and for what I am, to come in to my life and change me from the inside out. And I got out of prison December 31st, 2001, on fire for God.
Bob never touched drugs again. Today, he's a single dad raising his daughter, Eden. Bob is a territory manager and technician for a mobile medical company, and he and his daughter live in Iowa.
Being sold out for God is amazing. And if you're sitting there as a skeptic saying, I've tried this, I've tried that, I went to church, I did this, and nothing's changed, you haven't truly sold yourself out. There's always going to be highs and lows here on earth. This is not our destination. We are promised paradise and eternal oneness with God. The story is the God of the universe, the creator of all, can take you as you are, whatever you've done, no matter what you think you've done or you're not worthy, and take you and give you hope, life, a future, and show you there is a better way.
I was recently reading a piece on many of the young people today who are into fame and fortune. I mean, they're preoccupied with this. And I don't want to get into my whole world story, but years ago when I was in rock and roll, as Terry mentioned it a moment ago, I hung out with people like the Beatles. My wife toured with them. The Rolling Stones, Bob Dylan, Jimi Hendrix, Brian Jones of the Stones. A number of those people are dead. And that's because of the whole drug thing. And I must admit and will freely say that I got involved with drugs for a period of time. I'm sitting here now by the grace of Almighty God. That's not just a word. God came, and we talked in the previous show about angels, came and saved my life from that stuff. It is a lie. You know, many states in the United States today are legalizing marijuana. And people are smoking dope and saying it's fine, it won't do you any harm. Well, it is a pathway to death. It really, really is. And I smoked dope for quite a while. And it almost killed me because it led to the next thing, which was LSD and other drugs. And I called on God in a moment of desperation. I was raised in a Christian home. My father was a minister, all of that. But here I was smoking dope and trying to be a star. It's a lie. There's a way that seems right to a person. It ends up in death. Jesus said, I've come to bring you life. Now, it's your choice. He's not going to impose anything. There's nowhere in Scripture that Jesus came along and said, you must follow me. He said, choose this day who you're going to serve. Now, folks, if you're into dope, alcohol, whatever else, you don't even have to have these addictions. It's just life itself. And Jesus said, I've come to bring you life more abundantly, above anything we're breathing now. And he controls the breath in our nostrils. So if you want to know what life is really all about, ask him. Just ask him where you are right now. You don't have to go into a long litany of religious prayers. Just say, Jesus Christ, come into my life, reveal yourself to me, ask, and he will come to you right now. You can call. There are people there, 1-888-777-1999, or Facebook, or any other source of communication. We're here to help you, and the Lord is as near as the words in your mouth, and he will set you free from anything that's trapped you. He has come to set you free. And there's a little phrase we used to use, freedom is only in the truth, and the truth will set you free. Truth is not a philosophy, it's a person. His name is Jesus.
Well, up next, the radio host who was too hot for the airwaves. Find out when the music died. That's next.
I am Professor Radisson.
Fill in the papers I've just given you with three little words.
God is dead.
I can't do what you want. I'm a Christian.
On March 21st.
What do you say to people who don't believe?
We disown him, he'll disown us.
When your faith is tested.
We're going to put God on trial.
Fight for what you believe.
God's not dead.
Science supports his existence. You know the truth. Why do you hate God?
God's Not Dead, rated PG. In theaters March 21st.
I was having some pains between my shoulder blades. At that point, everything changed. Diagnosis, pancreatic cancer.
First, there was prayer. The second is to fight. As soon as we walked through those doors at Cancer Treatment Centers of America, all my anxiety left. The pastoral care here is based on the Bible, based on the Word of God, just as it is at our own church.
When you combine the great medicine with the spiritual resources we have, it provides the patients with something that really can make a difference.
You got a pastor right there on staff praying with patients, and whether it be scripture or whether it just be a word of encouragement to say, God's got this.
If you or someone you love is fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com/faith. You'll learn how our treatment results compare to national averages and see a list of insurance plans with which we've worked. Advanced medicine and technology, the warm embrace of the Spirit.
I firmly believe God led me here.
Call or go to cancercenter.com. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits. Appointments available now.
I could go hours and hours on live television doing my job at a very high level and then go home and collapse. And I was in New York City, and I really was trying to drink myself to death. I was so depressed. I couldn't eat. I couldn't keep food down. I just did not want to go on. And they took me to the hospital, and I still wanted to die. I asked God to let me die. I hear a voice in my spirit that says, no, I want you to live. And that was the moment I really realized, okay, I have to make a choice. Do I live, and how do I live? As I've begun to give my testimony, people have shared with me their own struggles. And I can tell you, I'm not the only person who ever sat on a couch watching the 700 Club with a bottle of vodka in my hand praying with Pat. There are a bunch of us out there. It just took us a long time to get to the right place.
Rob Echno was a radio star. Whenever he got behind a mic, his voice could be heard for miles. But even though Rob's voice launched his career, it was another voice that saved his life.
Rob Echno was born with the gift of gab. For most of his life, he has made his living from talking, whether as a DJ, an actor, or a Shopping Channel host. Rob fell in love with radio in high school when one of his teachers helped the students raise money for their own radio station.
He was my inspiration. We actually went out, started a 200-watt FM station, got our license, and a lot of people have had great careers because of that.
Rob studied communications at a local community college, and he was even elected class president, but also loved the party scene.
I just got into partying big time. We had keg parties at our house every Monday night. We'd watch Monday night football, play poker till 2 minutes before class started, race to class. It wasn't the best example to be a class president of your college, and you're the leader of the party crew out there as well.
Despite his lifestyle, Rob managed to graduate and enrolled in a four-year program. While still a student, he was offered a job as a DJ in a top radio market in Massachusetts. At night, he spun platters at a Mexican restaurant and later at a strip club. That's where he tried cocaine for the first time.
There I was with mayors and police chiefs and city councilmen literally 5 feet in front of me, and I'm playing music for all these naked ladies, and I've got lines of cocaine, and I'm getting drunk and stoned, and it was quite a mess.
Rob's friends envied his early success, but his lifestyle and cocky attitude eventually caught up with him. He was fired from his radio job when he made an offensive remark. He also stopped attending classes and flunked out of school.
And I ended up DJing at nightclubs and partying with the bands until all hours of the morning and things like that.
Eventually, he found work as a news reporter and then as a media relations rep with several sports teams, but his drug use consumed his life. One year, Rob sold his house and made a $35,000 profit, but spent it all on cocaine. He lost everything and moved to Fort Lauderdale, Florida, where he became homeless.
Anytime I did gather a little bit of money, it would always went to try to find a dope dealer or a bottle of booze.
Rob attended a local church there, even though he would show up high most of the time.
But I used to walk 3 miles in the heat every Sunday, and I'd go to church stinking in the pews. I'd walk into the men's room, and I know at least once or twice I actually snorted lines of cocaine at church. And I'd be sitting there, and the pastor every week I would say, wow, how does he know me? It's like he's only talking to me. So God obviously was trying to get me a message through all my insanity.
One day he was watching the cruise ship sail into port and decided life wasn't worth living.
One day it hit me in the head and I said, listen, what is the point of me wasting another day on the sidewalk here? I'm taking up space from people that have a life. I have no life. So let me just end it all. So I was literally walking over to where all the big cruise ships come in Fort Lauderdale. I knew I couldn't swim, but my luck, it would be the one day in my life that I could swim. So I said, at least if I end up being able to swim, one of those cruise ships will just, you know, plow me right over and it'll be over. But it was weird. I was walking over there and God obviously had a different plan for me.
At that moment, Rob heard a voice telling him to go to California. So he decided to move out west, but first he went to visit friends up north, where he had another life-changing experience, a DUI.
The day after Thanksgiving, November 28, 1992, I ended up having a fight with my girlfriend. It was Thanksgiving night. I went out, got drunk 200 yards from the police station at 2 o'clock in the morning. I get pulled over. And when she came to pick me up a couple hours later, I just looked at her and I said, man, I'm done. I cannot do this anymore.
Rob entered a 12-step program and got sober. He finally moved to Burbank, California, and contacted a woman there about a room she had for rent.
When I talked to this girl, it was funny because she's like, oh, you can't move in with me. You're a guy and I'm a Christian gal and, you know, blah, blah, blah. But come to this church called Church on the Way with Jack Hayford. And she said, you know, there's a Friday night singles meeting. Come meet me there and we can at least chat and we can talk. Maybe I can help you get a place to live.
Although Rob had been sober for over a year, he knew he needed to take the final step and pray to receive Christ.
And she talked to me for a little while and I said, you know what? It's time for me to fully give my life to God because I don't want to be drunk and stoned anymore. I want to rebuild my life. God knows this, so let me give my life to Him and let Him guide me.
Since then, Rob has worked as a host for several shopping channels and as an actor on the News Radio TV show with Saturday Night Live stars John Lovitz and Phil Hartman. Today, he is married to Tammy and hosts a popular Christian internet radio talk show called In Your Face.
The purpose of the show is to inspire, motivate, and challenge each of us to become the best we can be for ourselves, our country, and most importantly, God.
Rob is also active in helping the homeless and other ministries in Southern California.
That's what Jesus put me here to do, and all of us. We're supposed to care about one another. My motto this year is exactly that. What can I do for you? Because if I'm doing something for you, it means I'm doing work for God. And if I'm doing work for God, that means my life's going to be okay.
What a rocky road we travel on our way to truth, don't we? I just, as I listen to Rob's story, I just think of that old adage, what tangled webs we weave. And yet, through it all, God is with us, pursuing us. He wants us. Why? I don't understand. Because sometimes the messes that we get ourselves into make us so unlovely, make us just so rebellious, so distant, so unwilling to receive the love of a God who has given all so that we could know Him and He could have relationship with us. It's astonishing, isn't it? So astonishing that I think it's sometimes hard for us to come to because we ourselves recognize that we are unlovable. And then in the midst of all these crazy choices that we make, We actually trade our inheritance for a mess of pottage. We give it all up for something that smells bad, looks bad, is bad for us, takes us even deeper into places of sin that we never intended to go to. And then one day we wake up and say, what am I doing here? In this situation, God sent someone on numerous occasions to Rob to say, there's a better way than this. There's a better way. That's what God wants you to know today. You know, lots of times as Christians, we sort of come into the reality of our relationship with the Lord in phases. I mean, here's Rob going to church, you know, still doing drugs in the bathroom at church, because there's something in us that knows there has to be more. There's something in us that wants to be free, that wants to know truth, that wants to be loved. One of the things I love the most about God, he has so many amazing attributes, but is that he takes our junk after we give it to him. And he turns around and helps us be able to be utilized by him to bring truth to someone else. You know, here's Rob today working to help other people. You know, that wasn't even on his agenda before. God sets us free, free from ourselves, free from the junk we've allowed into the space of our lives, free from the things that have come to put us in bondage, free from the things that hold us. And you can have that today too. How do you get that? You know what? You can't earn it. There's nothing special you can do that's going to make God say, aha, I'm going to set that one free today. You know how it happens? You grab hold of it and you say yes. You grab hold of him and you say yes. So right now, just do that. Just get on your knees before the living God and say, I am a sinner in need of a Savior. And God, thank you for waiting for me. I am so sorry that I've put you through this, that I've done this to my own life, that I've missed everything that you wanted to be and do in my life. And yet I receive the offer you give me to have a new beginning. Say yes today. It's available to you. Whosoever will may come. That's what the Word of God says. If you'd like to pray with someone about a specific need in your life, or if you'd just like to confirm with someone that, yes, today I've heard truth and I have surrendered my life to the Lord, call that number that is on your screen right now. It's toll-free, 1-888-777-1999. The person on the other end of the line is somebody who's already prayed that prayer we're talking about, and they would love to pray with you and for you today. So please, call now. No condemnation, no judgment. Just a friend who wants to lead you to the foot of the cross where they found freedom. So call now. Scott?
We're sitting here watching these stories. They're real. We didn't make them up. This is reality, folks. And here's another one. Coming up, a baby born deaf hears his first sounds. Find out how next.
When you want the latest information about your health, when you have questions about handling your finances, when you need prayer and inspiration to live a more abundant life, and when what's happening in the world impacts your community and your family, turn to the 700 Club for analysis and insight into the events of the day. The 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
I'm Professor Radisson.
Fill in the papers I've just given you with three little words.
God is
dead.
I can't do what you want, I'm a Christian.
On March 21st.
What do you say to people who don't believe?
If we disown him, he'll disown us.
When your faith is tested.
We're going to put God on trial.
Fight for what you believe. God's
not dead. Science supports his existence. You know the truth. Why do you hate God?
God's Not Dead, rated PG, in theaters March 21st.
One of the greatest joys for parents is hearing their children learn to speak. For one Chinese couple, the sound of their daughter's voice was especially sweet because it's something they never thought they'd hear.
When Mrs. Shun heard she was going to have twins, she cried because the doctor told her and her husband that one twin had water on her brain and suggested Mrs. Shun have an abortion.
My heart sunk when I heard one of my babies might be handicapped. My whole world just started spinning, and it felt like I was going to fall off of a cliff. How could I not even give them a chance to see this world?
So after the babies were born, the poor couple worked extra long hours to get twin Shin Ron the medical attention she needed. And against all odds, the water on her brain disappeared. But Shin Ron had yet another challenge.
I noticed that if there was a dog barking, my Shin Ron had no response. She couldn't even hear it when I rang a bell by her ear. Shin Ron was deaf.
The Shuns used the rest of their savings to buy Shin Ron a hearing aid and sent her to speech therapy. But just as she was starting to make noticeable progress, her hearing aid broke. And there was no way they could afford another one.
I was so worried about her future. She couldn't go to school anymore. How would she find a job?
When CBN heard about Shin Ron, we bought her the best digital hearing aid available.
When she put on her new hearing aid, she said, "I love you, Mama and Papa." I just held her and cried.
Now she will have a wonderful future. It's more than we ever could have dreamed of.
Today, Shin Ron is happy and healthy and doing just as well as her twin.
I used to think there was no one who cared in the world, but I was wrong. You care. You cared about my little insignificant family and reached out your helping hand to keep us from falling off of the cliff.
Thank you for everything.
She's adorable, isn't she? You know, being able to catch this in her life at this early stage will allow her to have wonderful speech, clear speech, a job down the road. She will not be the object of people putting her down or laughing at her because she can't hear or speak. You've saved this little family from a future that would have been quite hopeless. And that's just one of the things that 700 Club members are doing around the world. Be a part of making a difference like that. I'll tell you, it makes such a difference in your own heart and life. When you join the 700 Club, it's a 65-cent a day, $20 a month commitment. And you can do that right now. Go to your phone and call the number again that's on your screen, 1-888-777-1999. When a friend answers on the other end, just say, "I want to join the 700 Club," and we welcome you to the family of ministries here. Well, right now, we've got some activity in our chat room. Margrit's over there. Tell us what's going on.
Yes, Terry, this is from Brad. How do I work in the entertainment industry and not get overwhelmed by the world?
Well, Scott, that's your bailiwick. Go for that.
Oh, my. I tell you, it's such a trap. You know, you can be gifted. You're a singer. And you can really have that gift.
Yes.
And but around all that is all the entrapments
yes.
of the industry. You know, it really is. And so I would simply suggest that this gentleman wants to sing. He can sing for the Lord. He can do that.
Yeah.
But don't get trapped in that stuff. Delight yourself in the Lord. He will fulfill the desires of your heart. So give it all to God. Give your talents to God. What he gives back to you is a gift.
Yeah.
And stay away from all the hustlers that
yes.
will try to use you and spit you out like yeah. a prostitute.
They always appeal to your ego in that.
Yeah, they do.
And since you're your own product, that's a tough one to get away from. Fellowship, too, you know, being in a good church and having friends who surround you. Good, good things. Well, we leave you with these words from Psalm 95 today. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. God bless you.